Mentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Telephone Line by Julie Mulhern, narrated by Callie Beaulieu. 1. April 1975, Kansas City, Missouri. The heels of my hands and the balls of my feet pressed into the yoga mat, my hips stretched for the ceiling. "Deep breaths," the instructor intoned. "Breathe through your body, all the way to your toes." I wasn't zen enough to breathe to my toes. Breathing through my lungs was all I could handle. "Reach," said Marigold, the woman at the front of what had once been Winnie Flournoy's third-floor ballroom, now the enormous room served as a yoga studio. "Breathe." "Next to me," Libba muttered. Apparently, today's yoga class wasn't living up to her expectations. Instead of the gentle, easy exercise Winnie promised us, we'd sweat. Sweat hard enough for dampness to stain my leotards. I would ache tomorrow. "Sink into a child's pose," Marigold told us. We sank. "Let's move to our backs." We moved to our backs. "And breathe." We breathed. "Close your eyes." My eyes closed to half-mast. "And find your center." "What?" "Breathe in through your nose, out through your mouth." That I could do. So could Sharon Michaels. She stretched out on the mat next to mine and followed instructions loudly. I concentrated on the music, something with a sitar and a violin. Normally, such noises would annoy me, but the pitch and tone suited the moment. The room was dim, the mat was comfortable, and I'd had little sleep. "Relax and breathe." I closed my eyes. "Drift on a cloud." I drifted. "Melt into your mats." I melted. I drifted and melted and dozed until the record skipped. My lids fluttered open. Around me, women remained melted on their mats. Sharon Michaels snored softly. Marigold was nowhere to be seen. I pushed up from the mat, went to the record player, lifted the needle and dropped it at the beginning of the album. The music began again. Someone sighed. I tiptoed to the bench running the length of the windowless wall and collected my shoes and handbag. No one moved. The door was just to my right. I turned the handle and pulled. The door didn't budge. I pulled again, harder. Nothing. I pushed. The door still didn't move. "Winnie?" My voice was low, but every woman in the room except Sharon opened her eyes. "Does the door stick?" I asked. "Of course not." I pulled again, hard. "How well do you know Marigold?" Winnie sat up on her mat. "Why?" "Because she locked us in." Winnie pushed herself to standing. "Don't be silly." I stepped aside and let Winnie try the handle. The door remained unmovable. "I'm sure there's a mistake." Marigold was probably downstairs cleaning out Winnie's jewelry drawer. "Do you have a phone up here?" "A phone? Up here?" She glanced around her private studio. "Why would I have a phone up here?" "In case her yoga instructor locked her in?" "Are any of your neighbors at home?" "How would I know?" Winnie wrung her hands and looked back at Libba, Kate, Sarah, Betsy, and the still-sleeping Sharon. Leaving her at the door, I picked my way through the yoga mats and peered out the front window. The street was quiet. The neighboring houses were far away. We might yell for hours before anyone heard us. "What time is your mail delivered?" 3 o'clock. I glanced at my watch. The time read 10:15. Spending 5 hours locked in Winnie's ballroom wasn't on my agenda for the day. There had to be another way out. Besides, in that 5 hours, Marigold could steal Winnie blind. "Is there a towel up here?" "A towel?" "Yes, a towel." "Why?" "Because I have a new tube of paint in my purse." I picked up the tube from the artist's supply store on Saturday and hadn't yet put it in my studio. As long as Winnie's towel wasn't cobalt blue, we were set. "We can write a message and hang the towel out the window." "What kind of message?" I'm thinking SOS. Winnie shook her head. I don't know, Ellison. Libba joined me at the window. She scowled down at the line of cars parked next to the curb on the quiet street. Your yoga teacher is probably downstairs helping herself to your grandmother's pearls. Winnie turned a sickly shade of green and disappeared into the half-bath, muttering something about how Marigold would never steal from her. She returned quickly and thrust a hand towel at me. Will this work? Do you have anything bigger or two more? I'll look, she snapped. Any semblance of calm or zen Winnie possessed had disappeared. Neither Kate nor Sarah nor Betsy retained any zen either. Their arms were crossed across their chests and their eyes were narrowed. What a disaster, declared Kate. I'm just glad our purses are here and not downstairs, said Sarah. Betsy merely shook her head. Do you need help painting the towels? She's an artist, said Libba. She can manage an SOS. Sharon snorted in her sleep. Winnie reappeared with an additional two towels. I spread them on the floor and finger-painted an S, an O, and another S. The letters were as large as I could make them in brilliant blue against the white of Winnie's towels. We hung one towel per window and sat down to wait. If I hung SOS towels out the window at my house, my nosy neighbor Marion Dixon would call the police within a half second, then step out onto her lawn for a better view of the action. Too bad Marion wasn't across the street now. Winnie, would you turn that inferno racket off, please? Betsy pointed to the record player. I'll do it. Libba lifted the needle off the album. The absence of sitar was a gift. How well do you know this woman? Sarah demanded. Did you get references? I'm sure she didn't mean to lock us in. Winnie was lying to herself and us. I have a tennis game at 1, said Kate. I have a dress fitting. I can't be late. Betsy's sweet voice fooled no one. If she missed her appointment, there would be hell to pay. I leaned against the window and stared at the street. Libba's Mercedes convertible was parked between Sarah's BMW and Betsy's Oldsmobile station wagon. Then came Kate's Cadillac and Sharon's Volvo. Behind the Volvo was a blue car. I turned back to the studio. Winnie, when I pulled up, I saw a plum-colored gremlin in the drive. Is that Marigold's car? Yes. Why do you ask? Because there's a blue car I don't recognize parked on the street. I tapped my fingernail against the glass. People park on the street all the time. Winnie dismissed my observation with ease. Outside, a figure appeared next to the blue car. I pounded on the glass, then raised the sash. Help! The person next to the car looked up at the house, at me, at the SOS towels, and covered his forehead with his hand as if a glare impeded his view. That, or he was hiding his face. Libba hurried to my side in time to see the man toss a large duffel bag into the front seat, slide into the car, and drive away. Didn't he hear you? Didn't he see your sign? He heard. He saw. And he drove away? He did. My stomach knotted into an impossible yoga pose. Something was very wrong. Behind us, conversation continued. Just where did you find this Marigold? Kate sounded deeply annoyed. She came highly recommended. Winnie's voice had a how dare you question me tone that wouldn't win her much support among the women locked in her attic. And you've been to dozens of classes here. There's never been a problem. Not until today. I'm sure this is a misunderstanding. Dream on, Libba whispered. No kidding, I whispered back. Look! Libba pointed out the window. An older woman and her dog had rounded the corner. They strolled toward Winnie's house. I wiggled my upper body out the window and yelled, Help! The woman on the sidewalk stopped. She glanced over her shoulder. She looked across the street. She even stared down at her little dog. The dog barked. Up here! Up here! The woman shifted her gaze to the attic and her jaw dropped. Surprise was a reasonable response. How often did one see grown women leaning out an attic window? We're locked in, I explained. Would you please call for help? The area near the window was suddenly crowded. "That's Gertie Kleinman. She lives 3 doors down. Ask if she'll come in and unlock the door. Mrs. Kleinman, will you please come in and open the door?" The woman nodded, and she and her dog hurried up Winnie's front walk. We waited. Was the front door locked? Gertie Kleinman was taking forever. "What's taking so long?" wondered Betsy. She still sounded sweet as pie, but the expression in her eyes was scary. Winnie squeezed her eyes shut and tapped her forehead. "I can't remember if the door is locked." Gertie Kleinman reappeared on the sidewalk, running away. She dragged her little dog behind her. "What's she doing?" Acid etched the sweetness in Betsy's voice. "Gertie!" Winnie nearly took out my eardrum. Gertie didn't stop. She didn't even slow down. Gertie ran. "What's that all about?" Kate demanded. "Is she unbalanced?" "The door must be locked. She's in a hurry to call for help. She'll send someone." Winnie's voice was full of bravado. "But why didn't she stop and tell us that?" insisted Kate. "She just ran." My stomach twisted into that upside-down yoga pose where feet crossed like pretzels. Gertie, who was no spring chicken, hadn't just run. She'd run like a fox pursued by a pack of hounds. The tight crowd of women near the window made breathing difficult. Or maybe the difficulty came from the sudden dread pressing against my chest. After a moment or two of watching the empty street, Kate and Sharon and Betsy faded away. Winnie watched a bit longer, then she too stepped back from the window. That left me with Libba and Sarah. I breathed deep. "Why did Gertie run like that?" asked Sarah. "Why couldn't my stomach take a nice Savasana pose? Easy, relaxing, serene." But no, my intestines contorted into something impossible, a Vishva Midrasana. I'd seen it done once and still didn't understand how it was physically possible. "I have no idea." Sarah stood with us for another moment before she too drifted back toward the mat still spread across the floor. I wasn't surprised by the first siren's klaxon blare, nor was I surprised when 3 police cars parked in front of Winnie's house. I might have blinked once or twice when Anarchy and his partner Detective Peters arrived. "We're locked in the attic," I called down to them. The 2 men looked up at me. Anarchy rubbed his palms across his face. Detective Peters, who, despite the sunshine, was wrapped in a rumpled overcoat, merely scowled. "Who's that?" Sarah rejoined Libba and me at the window. She pointed at Anarchy. "Ellison's boyfriend," Libba replied. Her eyes widened. "I thought he was a homicide detective." I swallowed a sigh. "He is." A few moments later, a uniformed officer ushered us down Winnie's service stairs and into the backyard. All of us were happy to be out of the attic. All of us but Winnie. She expected to stay in her house. Anarchy, with his cop face firmly in place, stepped outside and approached us. Detective Peters followed him. "Who's the homeowner?" Anarchy asked.
"I am. I'm Winnie Flournoy."
"What's going on?" Anarchy ignored her question. "I take it you all were having some sort of exercise class?"
"The instructor locked us in the attic," said Sarah. Betsy glanced at her watch. "I have an appointment in less than an hour. May I leave, please?"
Sharon merely yawned. Anarchy waved over a uniformed policeman. "Officer Carson will take your statements. Ellison, Mrs. Flournoy, will you please come with me?" We followed him to the far reaches of the patio. Libba trailed after us. "What was your yoga instructor's name, Mrs. Flournoy?" Anarchy asked.
"Marigold."
"Do you have her last name?"
"Applebottom."
"Seriously?" I glanced at Winnie. "Marigold Applebottom?" Winnie didn't look as if she were joking. She looked exhausted, as if answering Anarchy's question had drained the last of her reserves.
"That's right."
"How long has she worked for you, Mrs. Flournoy?"
"Since January. It was my New Year's resolution to practice yoga 6 days a week. It started out with just me, then some of my friends joined the class.
Do the same people come every day?
Heavens no. They have bridge games, and now that the weather is better, they have golf and tennis games. Sharon has a book club every other Wednesday. Libba is my spotty attendee. Winnie glanced at Libba and shrugged. I'm sorry, but it's the truth, dear. We never know when you'll show up. She shifted her gaze to me. This is Ellison's first time. Marigold Applebottom had been coming to Winnie's house for more than 3 months, but today, the one time I'd come under duress, was the day something happened. Lucky, lucky me. Libba and I saw someone.
You what?
Anarchy's coffee brown eyes widened. While we were locked upstairs, someone carrying a duffel bag climbed into a blue car and drove away.
What's the big deal about that?
Detective Peters had snuck up on us. Maybe he couldn't help his snide tone. He could. He liked treating me like the village idiot. Whoever it was heard us yelling, saw us waving, and drove away. Peters snorted. Maybe they didn't want to get involved. I glanced up at Winnie's Georgian home. With towels hanging out the front window, you'd think he or she'd at least call for help.
What did he look like? Asked Anarchy.
Average height, tan windbreaker with a hood. I was too far away to see features.
What about the car?
American made, and blue. Anarchy nodded, slowly, as if he wished I'd been more observant. I'm sorry I'm not more help.
That's okay.
He turned to Winnie, and a sympathetic expression settled on his face.
Miss Applebottom is dead. We need someone to identify the body.
Winnie paled. Dead? She swayed as if the spring breeze might knock her down. I'll do it. One of these days I'd think before I spoke.
You're sure?
Winnie clutched my hand. You don't mind? Yes, I minded, but I'd seen enough dead bodies over the past months that one more wouldn't give me nightmares. I don't mind.
Thank you, Ellison. You're a good friend.
I followed Anarchy into the foyer and stumbled to a halt. Marigold Applebottom hung from a rope tied to the second floor banister.
She killed herself?
That's what it looked like.
But that couldn't be right. What about the person in the street?
We were meant to think it was a suicide, said Anarchy.
But it was a murder.
Peter snorted. He didn't appreciate my stating the obvious. I looked up at the woman.
That's definitely Marigold.
Anarchy nodded at a large man in a KCPD jacket. The man set a ladder under Marigold and lifted her body until the rope hung slack. Another man on the landing untied her. The first man descended the ladder and gently placed Marigold's body on the floor.
Has Winnie been robbed?
Nothing seems to be disturbed. When I discovered we were locked in the attic, I thought Marigold was a thief. I couldn't look at her another second. I shifted my gaze to one of the paintings hanging in Winnie's front hall. I bet she was helping the person with the duffel. She let him in. He stole whatever they were after. Then he killed her. Peters rubbed his chin. For the first time ever, he regarded me with something like respect. Then he remembered who I was, and he sneered, his upper lip brushing against his bushy mustache.
You're probably right. Anarchy sounded tired. Is there some place Mrs. Flournoy can go?
Go?
It will take us hours to process this crime scene.
Well, she can come to my house. We stepped onto the patio where Winnie and Libba waited.
Is it her? Is she?
Winnie held a shaking hand against her mouth.
Dead?
I nodded. You should come home with me. Winnie covered her eyes with her palms.
I need to call Lark.
Detective Peters shook his head.
I'm sorry, ma'am. We can't allow you inside until the scene is processed.
Winnie was tall and thin, with a shingled haircut and good bones, imposing. And right now she looked like the angel of death. If I'd been on the receiving end of the look she gave Detective Peters, I'd have retreated a few paces. The only sign Peters even noticed was his mustache bristling. Come with me, Winnie. We'll have coffee, the ultimate enticement, and I'll loan you some clothes.
You've done enough, Ellison. If someone will bring me a jacket, I'll wait here until I can get into my house.
She coupled this pronouncement with another angel of death glare at Detective Peters. He shrugged.
Where do you keep the coats?
You're sure you don't want to come home with me? It felt wrong leaving her alone in her leotard with a passel of policemen. I can stay. She shook her head. If you call Lark's office and ask him to come home, that's all I need.
Detective,
I added a heaping teaspoon of sugar to my voice and called after Peters retreating back. Has anyone called Mr. Flournoy? He paused, stiffened, and walked on without replying. I'll call Lark as soon as I get home.
Thanks, Ellison, for everything.
If you hadn't kept watch, we'd all still be locked in the attic. Our time in the attic. Halcyon moments before I'd somehow become embroiled in another murder. Mother would be apoplectic.
2.
Libba tightened her hands around the steering wheel and stared straight out the windshield. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
She cut her gaze my way. This morning wasn't exactly the stress reducer you were hoping for.
No, but that's not your fault.
Libba sighed and pulled into my circle drive, stopping the car near the front door. Still, yoga was my idea.
It's okay. Really. Do you want to come in for coffee?
No, thanks. I'd rather go home and shower. Hot water wouldn't wash away the stains left by murder. Being locked in a room while a woman was hanged to death downstairs made an indelible mark, one impervious to soap and hot water. I'd brushed against death often enough to know firsthand. Then I remembered Libba hadn't seen Marigold hanging from the banister. I sighed, opened the car door, and put my feet on the pavement.
Call me?
She grabbed my hand and gave it a squeeze. If you need to talk.
I will.
I watched her drive away, then opened the front door. Max greeted me with a grin and take-me-running nudge of his head.
You'll have to wait, I told him.
His ears drooped, and the dejected expression on his face would have broken a softer woman's heart.
I'm sorry, but I need to sit down for a few minutes.
He followed me to the kitchen, where he flopped onto his bed with a put-upon snort. Aggie, my housekeeper, stood at the counter checking a list. She wore a daffodil-hued caftan and had the glow of a woman who'd spent the whole weekend with a man who adored her. She smiled, and a golden aura settled on her shoulders.
Good weekend?
The answer was obvious. She blushed and stuffed a list into her handbag, brown leather painted with smiley faces.
How's Mac?
Mac was the new man in Aggie's life. He had the easygoing, eager-to-please disposition of a Labrador puppy. He sent Aggie flowers just because. He owned a deli that stocked my favorite finocchiona salami. He made Aggie smile. I liked him. Aggie's blush deepened, and she hooked the handbag over her shoulder.
He's fine.
She took in my current state, and her dreamy smile faded away.
What happened?
I went to yoga with Libba, and the teacher was murdered. Aggie dropped her purse on the counter.
Sit down. I'll make coffee.
Aggie was good people. I collapsed onto a stool, told her everything, and drank some of Mr. Coffee's magic elixir.
What can I do?
She topped off our mugs, then rinsed the near-empty pot. I shrugged.
Nothing.
I was on my way to the market when you came home. I can pick up the ingredients for a bun cake. Who would we take it to? She ceded my point with a quick nod of her chin.
Go do your errands, I told her. I know you have things to accomplish today.
She picked up her handbag.
I won't be gone long.
Max and I stood at the door as she drove away. I scratched behind his ears. He rubbed his head against my leg and looked up at me with liquid, "Can we go running now?" eyes.
Later.
I promise.
Bring.
Bring. I let the phone ring 3 times, was tempted to let the answering machine pick up, but some masochistic streak deep within me had me reaching for the receiver. Hello? Tell me it isn't true. No, hello. No, how are you? Mother was deeply outraged. I should have let the machine pick up. Tell you what isn't true. Mother huffed as if she didn't have time for my foolishness. Oh, tell me you did not find a body at Winnie Flournoy's. I did not find a body at Winnie Flournoy's. I hadn't found the body. Gertie Kleinman found the body. But you were there. Yes. And someone was murdered? Yes, the yoga instructor. Mother's answering silence spoke volumes. I wrapped the phone cord around my fingers and waited. You were taking her class? I was. She locked us in the attic. A moment of silence ensued. Maybe this is a good thing. I blinked in surprise. A good thing. Being locked in the attic or the murder? I was pretty sure Marigold Applebottom's loved ones would consider her death a bad thing. What do you mean? You've found your body for the month. You won't have to worry about someone being murdered at the gala. The gala. Against my better judgment, I'd agreed to be the chairman for the museum's gala unveiling the Chinese exhibit. The exhibit would appear in only 4 cities, San Francisco, New York, Washington, D.C., and Kansas City. And the opening gala was a big deal. The committee and I had been planning and meeting and discussing flowers and food and table linens for months. Months. Now the countdown was on. Only a few weeks remained to iron out the final details. The evening promised to be the social happening of the season. Mother lived in fear a murder would spoil the event. Given my track record, her worry was justified. I didn't find Marigold's body. Marigold? I could hear the curl of Mother's lip. Yes, what a name. I didn't argue, nor did I tell her about the Applebottom part of Marigold's name. I didn't mean that her murder was a good thing. It's just that... Mother thought my proximity to Marigold's murder should count for something with the deity who regularly put dead bodies in my path. If only I was that lucky. There's been enough upheaval this month already. Mother was absolutely right, and we'd barely dipped our toes into April. You should be concentrating on the gala. She was singing to the choir. Promise me, Ellison, you won't go looking for trouble. I never do. Mother's silence was louder than a jackhammer. I don't. Then, because I sensed she had more to say about my finding bodies, I added, Listen, Mother, I'm a sweaty mess. I'm going to jump in the shower. May I please call you later? I'm on my way out for bridge. She exhaled loud enough for me to hear the depth of her worry. Go, take your shower, and try, Ellison, to stay out of trouble. I will. Bye. I hung up the phone. Max lifted his head from his paws. A run, now? Sorry, buddy. I promise I'll take you later. I had things to do. He huffed his displeasure and lowered his head. Ding dong. Seriously? What now? Max leapt to his feet and took off down the hallway. I followed at a more sedate pace. I didn't want people on the front stoop. I wanted a shower. And there was something I needed to do before I stepped into a stream of hot water. Something I needed to check. Something important. I opened the door. Marcia Clayton stood on the other side. She took one look at my messy hair and sweat-stained leotard and said, I'm sorry. I should have called first. I might look awful, but Marcia looked worse, like something the cat dragged in. Her face was pinched and pale. Her honey blonde hair was a fright. Her lipstick had bled into the tiny lines around her mouth. What's wrong? I asked. You don't know? Know what? her red-rimmed eyes filled with tears. "I've grounded Debbie for a month. Come in." I beckoned Marcia inside before my nosy neighbor could pull out her binoculars. Then I hauled Max away from Marcia's crotch. Marcia didn't look as if she was in the mood for one of his exploratory sniffs. "What can I get you?"
"Nothing."
"You're sure?" She nodded, and I led her into the living room.
"Please, have a seat."
I waved to the couch, then settled into the club chair closest to her. Marcia didn't say a word. She glanced down at the hands clasped in her lap. She bit her lower lip. She tapped her twined fingers against her forehead.
"Marcia?"
She shook her head. She wiped beneath her eyes. She stared up at the ceiling.
"Marcia, what's happened?"
I waited and waited. She shifted her gaze to a still life hung on the far wall.
"You've had a hard year."
"Yes. My husband had been killed. I'd been a suspect in his murder. Then, much to Mother's horror, I'd begun finding bodies."
"How do you..."
She ducked her head.
"How do I what?" "Find the strength to face the day."
Marcia spoke to her lap.
"Oh,
that. I take one day at a time."
"I never dreamed Debbie would lie to me."
"She's a teenager." She clasped her hands together, tight enough for her knuckles to whiten.
"I know my friends are whispering. How do you deal with that?"
I had no idea what she was talking about, lying or whispering.
"With what? How do you handle your friends talking about you behind your back?"
"Oh, that." I chose not to hear them. I'd learned long ago no one was perfect, and if I expected too much, I was destined for disappointment. Cheating husband, friends who were sometimes less than loyal, a mother who did her best to manage my life. If I let those things bother me, I wouldn't make it through a day.
"I know what people are saying."
I resisted the urge to close my fingers around her shoulders and shake her.
"About what?" "They're saying we're bad mothers because our girls went to that awful bar."
"What bar?"
"Dirty Sally's."
"Oh, dear Lord."
"When?" "Saturday night."
I exhaled. "Grace didn't go to a bar on Saturday night."
"Yes, she did."
"Grace was with me."
"That can't be right."
"It most certainly could. Grace and I had dinner with my parents, a command performance. Then we came home, made popcorn, and watched the late movie."
"But Debbie said Grace was with her."
Debbie stretched the truth. Debbie had lied through her just out of Grace's teeth.
"What happened at this bar?" "You're sure Grace was with you?"
"Positive." Marcia's cheeks paled, and she stood so abruptly she nearly knocked over the couch.
"Marcia, what happened? Debbie..."
She pressed her hand against her mouth.
"Came home drunk."
Making mistakes is how teenagers learn. A half gasp, half sob rose from deep in Marcia's lungs.
"I'm deeply disappointed in her. She swore to me that Dirty Sally's was Grace's idea."
"Grace was with me." "Don't worry about what people say. Ignore everything. It's one weekend. It'll be forgotten as soon as a major scandal hits. Like marigold apple bottoms swinging from Winnie and Lark Flournoy's banister." A tear ran down Marcia's cheek.
"I'm not like you. I'm not strong. I care when people say I'm a bad wife or mother."
Much of my sympathy for Marcia dried up. What do other people's opinions matter? "Debbie matters," she sniffed, a wet sniff.
"I could kill them both. Debbie and the..."
She held a fist against her mouth.
"Debbie and whoever convinced her to go to that bar."
Marcia lifted her gaze and stared into my eyes.
"I really could kill them."
"I understand." I didn't. Not unless there was something major Marcia had neglected to tell me.
And Bill...
Again her teeth knotted her lower lip. A fresh veil of tears dampened her cheeks. Bill was Marcia's husband.
What about him? He's just destroyed. It's as if something inside him has collapsed.
Something very major.
Marcia, what happened?
She waved me off.
I'm sorry to have disturbed you with this. I'll see myself out.
When Marcia left, I leaned against the front door. What in the world had that been about? Grace would know. With a sigh, I tiptoed into my late husband's study and closed the door. Tiptoed, because I didn't want anyone, not even me, to realize what I was about to do. My late husband had done things I didn't like to think about. True, he'd been an upstanding member of the community. True, he'd been a good provider. True, he'd adored our daughter. But Henry's faults as a husband outweighed the good. He'd cheated on me with friends. He'd cheated on me with strangers. He'd cheated on me with women who carried handcuffs and whips. To say our marriage wasn't in the greatest shape before I did the unforgivable was an understatement. My unforgivable sin? I earned more money than he did. The first year was a fluke. The second year was a problem. A big problem. Money was the yardstick by which Henry measured his manhood, and all of a sudden his wife's stick was longer than his, proving he was still in charge, in control, the master of the universe, became his number one priority. Proof could be found dominating me in the bedroom. When I declined to play with his toys, handcuffs and whips, he'd turned first to other women, then to ferreting out our friends' secrets. He extorted money from a surprisingly long list of people. It wasn't about the money. We had plenty. For Henry, it was about control. When he had someone's secret, he controlled them. He had the power. He was the master of the universe, at least in his own mind. I didn't know about Henry's blackmail hobby until he died, until I found his files. That discovery had been a shock. Unsure of what to do, I'd left the files where I found them, locked in the safe in his study. The extortion had stopped. I spent sleepless nights wondering what to do. Return the files? But how? Burn them? Did his victims think their blackmailer had just disappeared? Died? Run away to Bali? Ended up in prison? One thing was certain. I could never reveal what Henry had done. Our daughter didn't need to carry the weight of her father's sins. I should have fed the files into the living room fire over the winter, but I'd put them out of my mind. I'd shoved them into a tiny closet in my brain and thrown away the key. I'd forgotten about them on purpose. Until today. Until a murder happened in one of Henry's victims' houses. I sat on the edge of my late husband's desk and stared at the safe, Pandora's box. I racked my brain but failed to recall Lark Flournoy's secret. I couldn't remember a single detail. I just remembered he possessed a secret he'd paid to keep quiet. I pushed off the desk, wiped my damp palms against my tights, and spun the safe's dial. The door swung open, and I gazed into the safe's depths. Henry's files were alphabetized. Flournoy rested near the middle. With the file in my shaking hand, I settled into a chair and spread the papers across the massive expanse of Henry's desk. My husband had made meticulous notes, as if neatness counted in blackmail. My stomach twisted. There was something wrong about peeking at my friend's deepest secrets. The act felt dirty, despicable. No wonder Henry had enjoyed it so. With the tips of my fingers, I moved the pages and read. 10 years ago, Lark had colluded with an attorney named John Wilson. Together, they'd thrown a case. Henry was thin on the facts of the case, but eloquent on the repercussions. If Henry went public, Lark would be disbarred. Problematic for a district judge. At least now I knew Lark wasn't cheating on Winnie, or he hadn't been when Henry was gathering information. Tap, tap. I jumped, as if I'd been doing something wrong. Yes? It's me, said Aggie. I just wanted to let you know I'm back. Thank you. I leaned my head against the back of the chair and rested my hands on my knees until they stopped shaking. I'll be out in a minute. Do you want anything? Aggie sounded worried. Me spending time in Henry's study was a reason for concern. I avoided the room for multiple reasons. The contents of the safe, the lingering memory of the body I'd found sprawled across the carpet, my inability to find a decent decorator. How about coffee? She asked. I wanted wine. And a bath. Not right now. Aggie's worry, I never turned down coffee, seeped through the door's 8 panels. I picked up a chicken for dinner tonight. I thought I'd roast it. Sounds delicious. What time is she coming? What time is who coming? Your new neighbor, I sagged in the chair. Is that tonight? Yes. Ugh. Jennifer and Marshall Howe had relocated from California, knew no one, and Marshall traveled. I couldn't imagine living in a city where I didn't know a soul. Couldn't imagine spending night after night alone in a big house with no one for company. I'd invited Jennifer to dinner. When I'd asked her, I hadn't anticipated a murder, but it wasn't as if I could call and uninvite her. I told her 5:30 for drinks. We can eat at 6:30. You're sure you're all right? Positive. I pictured Aggie leaning her forehead against the door and added, I'll be done in here in a minute. I jammed the papers back in the file, put the file in the safe, and locked Henry's collection of horrible secrets away. Then I went to the guest bathroom and scrubbed my hands with French milled soap. The suds did nothing to wash away the filthy things my husband had done, but at least my skin smelled like hyacinths. Max poked his head into the powder room. A run, please. It didn't make much sense to shower before a run. Fine, he wagged his stub of a tail. I trudged up the stairs. No way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.